Hello friends, this is Dr. Sangeeta from Dental Pachala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And today's topic is the anchorage, so let's get started. So before we get started, make sure you subscribe to this channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a new video lecture. Now coming to anchorage, the forces which are used to move the teeth are derived from anatomical areas which are known as anchors, like anchor in the ship. Same manner, actually the Newton's third law of motion states that every action has equal and opposite reaction. So if you put an anchor, if you put anchor in the ship to stop the ship, so that's how we are using an anchor to do certain movement, to do the movements of the teeth. So as the Newton third law states that every action has equal and opposite reaction, and according to this law, the forces are used to move the teeth. So they are inducing equal and opposite pressure or forces on the anchor unit, and which causes the movement which we don't want. So the resistance which this anchor is offering, anchor is like how the anchor puts resistance in the ship, like it is not letting the ship move, the same way the anchor is not letting itself move. So in that case, in dentistry, in the anchorage and ortho, anchor is not moving, anchor is making the tooth movement. So anchor is the site from which we are withdrawing the forces, from which we are helping the tooth movement, and also these are the resistance which are offering these unwanted tooth movement are known as anchorage. So anchorage, according to White and Gardner, is the site of delivery. It is the site from which the forces are coming, the site of delivery from which a force is exerted. And according to Graber, it is defined as the nature and the degree of resistance to displacement. Now, it is providing a resistance to displacement offered by a anatomical structure or anatomical unit for the purpose of effective tooth movement. So it itself is providing resistance, but in turn it is producing tooth movement. It is not moving. The anchor unit, if we talk about the anchor, if it is present in the face, in the oral cavity, the anchor which we are using is not moving. Rather than that, it is doing the tooth movement. It is putting forces, like if we are pulling something from this area, then we are generating forces. So anchor basically is the site of delivery from where we are exerting the force, from where we are withdrawing the forces. So anchorage in the orthodontic therapy is mainly obtained from two sources. One is the intraoral source, the other one is the extraoral source. Now the intraoral source includes the teeth, bone, alveolar bone, the basal bone and the musculature. Now whenever some teeth are moved orthodontically, then the remaining teeth from which we are taking the support act as the anchorage or the resistance unit. Anchorage, we can also say the resistance unit. And the anchorage potential of the teeth from where we are taking resistance depend on certain factors. Now these are, if we are talking about from teeth, the factors are root form. See, the root form, actually the anchorage potential largely depends on the root form. If we take the cross section of the root, we have rounder roots, we have conical roots and we have triangular roots. If we talk about the rounder roots, are seen in the bicuspid and the palatal root of the maxillary molar, and these rounder roots actually exhibit the horizontal forces. Now in any direction, because these are round, so they are resisting the forces in any direction. And if we talk about the flat roots, for example in the mandibular incisor and molar, or buccal root of maxillary molar, if we talk about, they resist in the mesiodistal direction, because these are flat, so they are restricting in the mesiodistal direction. And if we talk about the triangular roots, such as which are present in the canine or in the maxillary center or the lateral incisors, they offer the displacement, more displacement. If we talk about the round root, because round, because they are triangular, so they are not letting the tooth move. So the triangular root offers the most displacement, most resistance. If we talk about the size and the number of root, now the more the size, more is the ability to withstand stresses, as we all know. So if they are multi-rooted, if we talk about taking anchorage from molars, they are offering more resistance for the tooth movement, and they are very good for taking support or anchorage. Now talking about the root length, longer the root, deeper it is embedded into the bone, and that's why it is providing more resistance to displacement. So if we talk about anchorage, longer root length are good for us, and inclination, the axial inclination is important also in assessing the anchorage. If greater resistance to displacement is offered when the tooth is exerted to move, is opposite to the axial inclination. Ankylosed teeth, because they lack PDL, right? So they are actually good for taking the anchorage, and they are best, excellent anchorage, because there is not going to be any tooth movement happening across it, because there is no PDL. And if we talk about the bone offers resistance to the tooth movement, and this when force is applied to a certain limit, then the bone permits the tooth movement and it produces bone remodeling, as we all know, Wolf-Schlauf transformation of the bone. And the basal bone or the jaw bones are intraoral source of anchorage, and we put implant also. So the best area is the hard palate and the lingual surfaces of the mandibular, and intraoral, if we talk about intraoral, hard areas are in the intermaxillary or in the intramaxillary anchorage. Now muscles, we also take support from the muscles. If there are suppose abnormal hypotonic muscle which is causing the flaring or spacing of the teeth. While if we talk about hypertonic muscles, they are actually exerting restrictive forces in the lingual direction. So if we talk about lip bumper, we are taking support from the hyperactivity of the hyperactive mentalis muscle, and we are doing distalization of the molar. Although this is less, we have already talked about this in lip bumper. Although this movement is very less, but it is actually helpful in distalizing the molar. Now coming to extraoral anchorage, we have occipital or the parietal anchorage, which we take from the cranium. So we are taking from the extraoral anchorage, we are using head gears along with the face bows, and we are taking anchorage either from the occipital area of the skull or the parietal area of the skull. And actually these are restricting the maxillary growth, or they are moving the maxillar bone distally. So because we are taking from the back, from the skull, and we are putting forces on the maxilla, either it is stopping the maxilla to grow or it is pushing the maxilla distally, used for class 2 cases. Now if we talk about the back of the neck or the cervical anchorage, now this cervical anchorage is taken from the cervical region, which is the neck region, and this type of headgear is known as the cervical headgear, which we use it. Now taking support from the facial bone, from the frontal bone, from the mandibular symphysis, is what we are talking about, the reverse headgears, which are taking support from the forehead and the chin. According to the manner of force application, how we are applying force, we have classified. This classification, what we have already covered, was the site of anchorage, where the anchorage is present. It is either intraoral or extraoral, which is present inside or outside. Now we talk about the where the force is applied, the manner of force application is the simple, stationary, or the reciprocal anchorage. The simple anchorage, it is an anchorage which is applying the force on the teeth and changing the axial inclination of the teeth. So only the inclination of the teeth is changing, nothing else is changing. So it is a type of anchorage which is changing the axial inclination of the teeth, and it is the resistance of the anchorage is providing the tipping movement of some other teeth, where the desired teeth, the desired movement is the tipping movement. So there is a principle in behind the anchorage, is that if we want to move one teeth, then the root surface area or the combined root surface area of this teeth, for example, if we talk about lateral incisor. So the root surface area of lateral incisor should be, if we want to take anchorage for doing a movement of lateral incisor, then it should be double the root surface area of lateral incisor. So we can either take support from the molar, we can take from the premolar, because the root surface area of both the teeth are double the root surface area of lateral incisors. So the combined root surface area of the teeth forming the anchorage must be double of the teeth to be moved. And the resistance offered by anchorage unit should be greater than the offered than that offered by the teeth being moved. So this, it should provide a greater resistance, and the root surface area should be greater, because otherwise this anchorage will start moving. See, if the root surface area of the teeth we are taking support is less, then the tooth itself will start moving. So anchorage, there will be loss of anchorage because the anchorage is start moving. So there is going to be no tooth movement. Instead, the anchorage, there will be a loss of anchorage. So coming to the second one we have is the stationary anchorage. Now this is the anchorage in which the application of the force is displacing the anchorage unit bodily. So the it is what the stationary anchorage is doing is the bodily movement of the tooth. You have to remember this. Now the anchorage provides the tooth resisting bodily movement, and it is greater than the tipping movement. Of course, we know that. And coming to the reciprocal anchorage, which is a frequently asked question. Now the reciprocal anchorage is the one which is, see, now according to the Newton's third law of motion, it states that we have already studied every action has equal and opposite reaction. So what it is saying is, if we put pressure from this side and if we are taking support from this side and both the teeth have equal forces, that means there is going to be movement in the other side also. So we are utilizing this thing to make desired tooth movement. For example, if we talk about midline diastema, and if we talk about there is midline diastema, okay, and we are using finger springs. So if we are using finger spring, then there is going to be the tooth is going to move in this direction. So if the first direction is this is the opposite direction of it. Or if we are using elastic bands for the treatment of midline diastema, or if we are using for cross bites elastics, for example, if we are using, then that is also equal and opposite. So, or if we are using coffin spring for arch expansion, so if the arch is going to expand, this is also equal and opposite. So these all are the example of reciprocal anchorage in which the resistance is offered by two units, which are when the equal and opposite force is dissipated and it is moving the tooth in the opposite direction of the other teeth. Now the two teeth or the group of teeth of equal anchorage are made to move in the opposite direction. So this is about the reciprocal anchorage where the opposite force is acting. Now coming to the two things, intramaxillary and the intermaxillary anchorage. Now there is a difference between these two, the intermaxillary, and this is according to the involvement of the jaw, according to the involvement, how the jaw is involved. Like inter means between the two things, right? Between the two things, and things we are talking is the jaw. So it is between the two jaws. That means between the maxillary and the mandibular. And if we talk about intra, that means within. Intra means within the same jaw. So intramaxillary is when the resistance, the offering resistance is situated when the anchorage is situated within the jaw. We are doing the tooth movement and taking anchorage from the same jaw. This is intramaxillary. And if we talk about intermaxillary, that means we are talking about maxilla and the mandible. Now there is something called as the Baker's anchorage. Let me tell you about Baker's anchorage. This is very easy. Now this is when the resistance unit is situated in the one jaw and the tooth movement is happening in the opposite jaw. So there are two intermaxillary, two Baker's anchorage. One is class 2 and the other one is class 3. Now class 2 is used in class 2 division malocclusion. Class 3 is used in class 3 division malocclusion. Now class 2 patient has proclined maxilla, as we all know. What we want to do is we want to distalize the maxilla. So if we want to distalize the maxilla, that means So if we want to move the teeth, which tooth we can move and which tooth we can take anchorage from? Always the tooth which is going to move is the one with the lesser root surface area, right? We all know this. And the one we are taking anchorage is double the root surface area. So that means molar is going to be the anchor tooth and the tooth which is going to move is the canine teeth. So we want to move the canine of the maxillary incisor distally for class 2, because in the case situation of class 2 malocclusion, there is proclined maxilla. So we want to push the maxilla, we want to push the canine distally. So what we are doing for class 2 is we are taking maxilla, canine and mandibular molar teeth and we are putting elastic band. So this is our class 2, because this way the anchor tooth is the one with the higher root surface area. This is very easy. Now don't get confused if they are asking the diagram question. For example, if you are preparing for NEET exam or anything, then don't get confused between this, because the one with the lower root surface area is always going to be the tooth which is going to be moved, and one with the higher root surface area is the one whose anchor tooth. So now the canine is going to come distally. So this is our class 2. If we talk about class 3, then class 3 is the proclined mandible. That means we want to distalize the mandible. So we are taking the tooth which is going to move is the mandibular canine, and the tooth we are taking anchorage from is our maxillary molar teeth. So this is our class 3. That way the force is coming on the canine and it is pulling the canine backward, and thereby it is decreasing the class. We can use this for elastics for class 3 treating, class 3 malocclusion cases. So this is about Baker's class 2 and this is about Baker's or intermaxillary class 3 anchorage. Now talk about simple, compound and multiple or reinforced anchorage. We will talk in detail about this. These are based on the number of the anchorage unit, how many anchorage units we are taking. So if we talk about single, that means the anchorage unit is one. This is very simple. So we are taking just one anchorage unit, like how we took for reciprocal, how we took for intermaxillary. So this is how we are taking just support from anchorage from the one teeth. We talk about compound, that means we are taking support from more than one teeth. So if we are talking about compound, these are the tooth, the support is used to move the teeth with less support is known as the compound anchorage. If we talk about multiple or reinforced anchorage, that means the anchorage or support we are taking are multiple. So there are three anchorage in this. The one is the head gears, because we are taking extra oral anchorage. So either I can write extra oral or I can write the head gear. The another one is the anterior inclined plane, or I can say suede appliance inclined plane. And the third one is the transpalatal arch or the lingual arches. So this is the transpalatal arch. And most important in the multiple or the reinforced anchorage, if the patient is uncomfortable wearing headgear, then we can put mini implants. So mini implants is also a kind of multiple anchorage. So extra oral headgear, if we talk about the forces which are generated from the extra oral sources, we can take it from the cranium, from the back of the neck, from the face. So these occipital parietal anchorage, cervical anchorage, facial bone anchorage are kind of multiple or reinforced anchorage. Multiple and reinforced anchorage is a frequently asked question in the NEET as well as for the final year BDS students. Now coming to the anterior inclined plane. Now anterior inclined plane are, these are inclined plane. So anterior inclined planes are the inclined planes along which the mandibular movement, the mandibular incisors, we are guiding the mandibular incisors path. So because we are guiding the mandible forward, there is forward gliding of the mandible during the closure of the jaw, like it is coming, the mandibular incisors are coming from here till here. So there is a forward glide of the mandible during the closure. So this result, this gliding results in the stretching of the retractor muscles of the mandible, and the muscles contract and the forces the mandible against the upper inclined plane. So it is forcing the mandibular itself against this plane. So there is a distal force which is applied on the maxillary mandibular teeth. So there is a distal force which is applied on the maxillary teeth, and this is the reinforced maxillary anchorage. So the modification of this anterior inclined plane is our Swede appliance, wherein this the acrylic plate is up to the upper incisal cap. So this hole is the acrylic plate. This is a Swede appliance where the anterior inclined plane has the incisal cusp capping. So this is also a modification of anterior inclined plane, which is a reinforced or the multiple anchorage. The third one is our transpalatal or the lingual arches. So the transpalatal or lingual arches, if we talk about the transpalatal, that means the molar is banded. So this is our transpalatal arch. And if we talk about the lingual, that means it is covering the lingual surfaces of the mandibular molar of the mandibular teeth and the banded with the mandibular molar's teeth. Transpalatal arch wire is actually the palate. It is moving the palate in the transverse direction by connecting with the first permanent molars. So on the either side, so these are the fixed mechanical therapy, these are the fixed anchorage. Similarly, if we talk about the lingual arches, if we talk about, so these are the contralateral, present on the contralateral lower molars, and these run across the lingual surfaces of the mandible, and it prevents the mesial movement of the lower molars, as well as these lingual arches and the transpalatal arches are banded with the first molars, both in the maxilla as well as in the mandible. So this is also a type of multiple or the reinforced anchorage. So the last one we have is our mini implants. So if the patient is not wearing extra oral appliance, or the patient is not wearing extra the headgear, then we can put mini implants on this. Now there are types of mini implant, or we can say micro implants. So the types of micro implant are based on the thread. Sabse pehle, the first one is based on the head. So exposure of the head. If the head is exposed in the oral cavity, that means it is open. So it is open method. If the head of the micro implant is inside the soft tissues, that means it is closed. Now also we are placing the implant based on that. We have two types. The first one is the self-tapping, which we talk about the smaller micro implants, smaller diameter micro implants. So we just make the tunnel, and in that we tap it, like we tap the implant. This is the self-tapping implant. Self-drilling implant is when the implant is drilled into the bone. So these are for larger diameter implants. So these are the drilling implant. So tapping and the drilling implant. The third one is based on the path of insertion. So unlike how we place the normal implants in the bone, is perpendicular, is actually parallel to the other tooth surface area, to the adjacent tooth, to the neighboring tooth. So there are for micro implants, because we want to take anchorage from, so these are based on the path of insertion. We have oblique path if the implant is placed in the oblique direction. If the implant is placed at an angle of 30 to 60 degrees along the long axis of the tooth, which is placed diagonally. So actually this method is used where there is the interradicular bone is very narrow. And the other one is the again perpendicular implant. Perpendicular implant are inserted perpendicular to the surface, and these are used when there is not much of interdental, interradicular bone present. So where do we place these micro implants? Like if we are retracting the maxillary posterior teeth. So if we are retracting the maxillary posterior teeth. So if we are retracting, we use in, that means we are using this implant. We are placing this implant in the tuberosity area, maxillary tuberosity area. And if we are retracting the maxillary anteriors, that means if we want to retract the maxillary anteriors, that means we have to place implants far back in the mouth. That means either we are placing the implant in the infrazygomatic crest, or we are placing implant buccally between the maxillary first and the second molar, or we are placing implant between the maxillary canine and the first premolar. So, or we are placing implant palatally. So, these two are the buccally, and if we are placing implant in the palatal region, then we can place between the maxillary second premolar and the first molar region. So, this is if we want to retract the maxillary anterior teeth. If we are pulling the maxillary anterior teeth in case there are proclination of the maxillary anterior teeth, as in case of class 2 division 1. And if we want to intrude the maxillary posterior teeth, also we put implants, micro implants in the same locations, in the infrazygomatic crest, buccally between the maxillary first and the second molar, buccally between the maxillary canine and the first premolar, and palatally between the maxillary second premolar and the first molar. So, and if we want to correct the unilateral cross bite, then we can put the implant in the mid palatal region. Now, coming to the mandibular, if we talk about these are in the maxillary region. If we talk about the mandibular, if we want to reintrude the mandibular molars, and if we want to retract the mandibular incisors, so this is the same thing. If we want to retract the mandibular incisors, or if we want to intrude the mandibular molars, then we place between the mandibular first and the second molar, like how we did in the maxilla. We place buccally, we are talking about buccally, between the mandibular first molar and the second premolar. So, the mandibular here, second premolar and the first molar, but in the maxilla it was placed palatally, in the mandible it is placed buccally. Also, we can place it in the retromolar region, and if we want to upright the mandibular molars, then we can also place in the retromolar region. And if we want to intrude the mandibular anterior teeth, so we put it in the facial, in the symphysis region. So this is about the anchorage. We have studied intraoral, extraoral anchorage. We have studied simple stationary reciprocal anchorage. Reciprocal anchorage is a frequently asked question. Then we have studied intramaxillary or intermaxillary anchorage, and that we have studied Baker anchorage, class 2 and class 3 Baker's anchorage. Also, we have studied simple compound multiple reinforced anchorage. Multiple reinforced anchorage is very important. It is also a frequently asked question. In that, we have studied head gear, anterior inclined plane. In that, we have studied suede appliance, and also transpalatal arch and the lingual arches. And we have studied the micro implants. So, all this you have to write if the anchorage question is asked for your BDS exams. So this is about the anchorage, and if you have any questions, you can leave it in the comment below, and also please leave comments. They are helpful and they keeps me going and motivated to put more videos. And if you feel that you have learned something new today and I have made you easy this topic, then please hit the like button, because this helped me to help you with your exam while you stay at home with your family in the lockdown.